hymns and praise songs together. You've gone from hymnals to screams, from a live pastor to a pastor. Well, I hope the pastor is alive. And notice I didn't say alive, just a live pastor, which means a person standing in front of you. From a live pastor to a pastor that is preaching at a location somewhere else in person, and is being shown in multiple locations across the United States or even around the world via video, or it could be a live feed to another building that's 30, 40, 50 miles away. And those are called campus, and they have campus pastors there, all right? Maybe you're one of those, worshiping's changed, where you meet at a particular location on Sunday morning or Saturday night or whatever else it may be, to worshiping at home on television or on our phone or laptop as we lay in bed, maybe as we drive down the road in order to go fishing. Worship used to be looked at as a time when you would dress up. Remember, wear your Sunday best. All right, wear your Sunday best. For most boys, it was a suit and a tie, or at least a tie and a shirt. And of course, you get chewed out when you fell down in the church parking lot and you ripped a hole in another pair of pants. And your mom looks at you and goes, "That's about the third or fourth pair of pants that you've ripped in the last couple of months." So she went out and got those little iron-on patches. Anybody remember them things? And iron it onto the knees of your pants so you could at least wear them another couple Sundays before destroying even that in there. All right? And you entered into the sanctuary. The sanctuary, what it was called, you quietly, you remained quiet during the service. If you weren't, mom or dad, if they were in the choir, would look down at you with the look of, well, you knew that look and you just better be quiet because it could be a very, very short ride up to heaven after church if you don't remain quiet. All right? You were even quiet as you left the sanctuary. Now there are welcome stations, coffee shops, kiosks to download the announcements or the notes from the sermons, pastor's sermon that morning. You do not have to wear your Sunday best anymore, but you can now come as you are as long as you have clothes on. The Bible used to be taught, but today you have the option to go to a place where you can hear the Word of God taught or hear a few stories and a few laughs. You might even get to hear a verse along the way. The list can go on and on and on, but we're going to stop here and let you make your own list as to what you expect in worship. But after this short list, after all is said and done, it all comes down to the main question that we're going to be talking about today is, what is worship? What is worship all about? What does it mean? To get us started today, we're going to take a look at the very last book of the Bible, which of course is the book of Revelation, and talk a little bit about that. Take a look at what John saw and wrote about when he was imprisoned on the island of Patmos. And God allowed him to get, in fact, God opened the door and allowed John to see some things, get a glimpse into heaven. So Revelation chapter 1, verses 10 through 14, you can go back and study this later if you'd like to, but I'll read it for you this morning. On the Lord's day, the Spirit took control of me, and behind me I heard a voice that sounded like a trumpet. The voice said, "Write in a book that you see, or what you see. Then send it to the seven churches of Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. When I turned to see who was speaking to me, I saw seven gold lampstands. There with the lampstands was someone who seemed to be like the Son of Man. He was wearing a robe that reached down to his feet, and a gold cloth was wrapped around his chest. His head and his hair were white as wool or snow, and his eyes looked like flames of fire." Now, I want you to imagine writing this down. Your imagination, your mind is in overdrive here. You know, you're trying to write down, figure out what all of this is, the lampstands and the person and all that's going on in this door that's opened up to heaven. And here John is trying to provide for us a glimpse of the splendor and the incredible glory and the beauty and majesty of heaven. And so after John writes down the best he could, he sends letters to the seven churches. And you can find these letters in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3. And by the way, I'm not going to read these chapters to you. You can do that on your own this week. You can go back and read them. And although I could and would read them for you, you just might be late for lunch, and I know you wouldn't enjoy doing that. So we'll leave that up to you to read Revelation 2 and 3 and even 4 and 5 over this next week. Now we move on to chapters 4 and 5. After the letters have been sent out, the church has got it, the lukewarm church, all these things going on. Chapters 4 and 5, where John tries to describe for us and give us a glimpse into what heaven is like as he witnessed the great worship service that is taking place around this throne of God with the seven gold lampstands. As the time is getting closer and closer to the unleashing of the final events in world history that I really believe we're seeing taking place today, all right, which led to the return of Jesus Christ. So as we look at most of our worship services, if you go to different worship services around the city, maybe you take a vacation and you happen to go to church somewhere, basically we have it broken down into three basic parts in our worship service. Number one is this: we praise God. Do that through singing, through fellowship. Maybe you get a cup of coffee and a donut and you sit around and you chit-chat with each other. Then we pray to God. Right? We pray to God and lift up His name. Hopefully you've done that before here. God, open my heart, you know, and let me, and prepare me for the worship service this morning. And then we preach His word. Okay? Basically three things. We praise God, we pray to God, and we preach His word. Hopefully His word is in there somewhere. Now, as you go back and read chapters 4 and 5 sometime this week, along with 2 and 3, all right, you may notice that only one of these parts will be part of our worship in heaven. Right? I don't believe that we'll have a need for prayer in heaven, at least as we pray on earth. Why? Why won't we need prayer in heaven? Well, if you think about it very long, it's because we will be in the physical presence of God. We no longer will have to pray to Him. We can walk up and just sit on His lap and talk to Him and be with Him and Him with us. I mean, just imagine how great that is going to be to actually see face to face the God, the Jesus, you know, that died on the cross for you, that created the world, talking person to person with Him any time of day that you wanted to do that. All right. The other thing we'll probably not need is, and I know some of you are going to say amen, is preaching. On the count of three, everybody say amen. 1, 2, 3. Amen. All right, tickle my fancy. Thank you very much. All right. We're not going to need preaching because we're standing and living in the presence of who? The Word of God. All right. He is the Word of God. All right. Who is Christ Himself. And this leaves us with only one thing that we'll really be doing in heaven, and that is worship. Worship. As you read through Revelation chapters 4 and 5, you're going to notice that no one is demanding that you worship. No one is going to demand that you worship. Hey, you're not worshiping. You're going to go to worship prison. You know, we're going to put a tattoo on you that says, this person didn't worship on a particular day. Right? They're not going to demand that you worship. No one is threatening you if you do not worship. Instead, what is going to happen, as you can see up here, is worship in heaven is going to flow out of the heart and the soul of every person and being. It's just going to come out. It's inside of you. It is just going to flow out. You're going to realize, oh my goodness, I'm in the presence of God Almighty. I'm in heaven, and it's just going to flow out. Why? Because you're going to know, they know that Jesus is no longer that baby in a manger. A lot of folks would think that's all who Jesus is. He was born, Mary and Joseph, they celebrate Christmas, they come back to Easter, last thing we knew, He died on the cross, rose again, and that's about all they know about Jesus, about God. They're going to realize that Jesus is no longer a baby in a manger. He's not the criminal hanging naked on a cross, being spit on, whipped, laughed at by those people that thought they were better than Him. The worship literally will break out, will just break out in one huge chorus because they realize that He is no longer a cold, dead corpse in a tomb, but instead He is the risen Savior. He is the risen Savior. He's in the world today, but one day we're going to be in heaven standing in front of Him, the risen Savior. The worship breaks out. The praise that breaks out is going to fill the heavens because they realize that Jesus is all in all, that Jesus is worthy of praise, that Jesus is exalted, lifted up above everything else. It is just going to bust out and flow out. You and I will never run out of things to thank Jesus for, to thank God for, to praise Him for. And your worship and praise will never, ever, ever be boring. It's just going to come out of you whether you want it to or not. As we shared at the beginning, John was experiencing two realities or places at one time. John was isolated. John was in prison on this island of Patmos, out in the middle of nowhere, where he had no friends, he had no family, and the main thing on his heart and mind was the persecution that the church was going through because of the Roman emperor. And it was at this time in John's life that God literally opened a door, opened a window into heaven, where John saw Jesus sitting on the throne with all the angels and the host of heaven, bowing down, singing praises and shouting praises that vibrated and flowed throughout heaven from one end to the other, from the top to the bottom. Worship. Praise that flowed from every being, every person in heaven, that took John from the loneliness and the desperation of discouragement and took him right into the very presence of God Almighty, where John could see God's purpose and God's plan for everything that would happen in the future. Wow! So how do we do this? How do we make the experience that John had and make it happen in our own life? Not just on Sundays, because that's not my job. That's not the purpose here. You should come in here ready to worship as a group. You should have worshiped throughout the week, prepared for worship long before you ever walk into this room. You ought to worship Him every day. So how do we make it happen in our own life? How do we get more out of showing up on Sunday morning, singing a couple of songs, hearing a message, putting our tithe in the plate, sing a song, and then go home? How do we get more out of it instead of just sitting out here going, man, I wish I was somewhere else. I bet the fish are biting. You know, I could be home in my bed right now. You know, whatever else it may be. All these kind of things. Let's look at four things this morning, or principles that just might be helpful for each one of us. So if you're ready, here we go. First principle is this: worship is not about you or us. It's all about Him. Worship is not about you. It's not about us. It's all about Him. Now I want you to read this with me, all right? We're going to read it out loud. We're going to do it twice. This is going to be on another slide, so I want everybody to read it out loud. Here it goes. Ready? Ready? Worship is not about me, it's all about Him. One more time. Worship is not about me, it's all about Him. Let me ask you a question. Do you really believe that? Oh, yeah. Okay? Now, as I said, you know, the answer to that question probably is a great big yes. I would say that. You know, it may be sometime during the worship service or sometime during the week. But do we really believe that? I'm not just talking on a Sunday morning or an occasional Wednesday night or sometime throughout the week when we're reading good devotion and it just jumps out at us. Now, as I said, most of us, not all of us, probably answered yes to that question. But here's the reality. You're sitting in a worship service and the worship leader announces a hymn that's new to you, or perhaps even a new praise chorus or song that you don't like. You just don't like it. What happens when there is some part of the worship service that isn't necessarily your vibe or to your taste? What happens when you think the music is too loud? Or maybe someone is singing or worshiping and they're singing loud and way, way off key. How are you going to feel then? You still going to worship? Is worship still about Him, or has it become all about me? I don't like that song. Music's too loud. I wish that person that can't sing would just not sing at all. Or maybe, better yet, go to another church where you can disturb them. I don't like the version of Bible that's being read, whatever else it may be. I'm going to be very open and frank with you. If you and I were to focus more on the object of our worship, we would be less agitated or irritated by the style of worship. Let me read that again. If you and I were to focus more on the object of our worship, which is who? Jesus, God. We would be less agitated and irritated by the style of worship. You see, one of the reasons, even the main reason, that we are all going to get bent out of shape and we bellyache and complain about worship is because we've forgotten that worship is not about us, it's all about Him. Jesus. Not to appease you or make you excited or whatever else it may you think it may need. You see, worship, genuine, true, pure worship, is to be offered up to the Lord from our hearts, our minds, our very soul, knowing and believing and living the reality, the truth, that the object of our worship, the Lord, is sitting on the throne, just like John saw through the doorway of heaven. Just like he was in this room, just like you're up there with John and you're peering through this window, through this door into heaven, and you're singing praise to him. The object of our worship. Second principle is this. This may surprise some. Worship is not about the here, it's about the there. Worship is not about the here, it's about the there. One of the most important purposes of worship is to get our minds and our attentions off the things that are going on around us. You got anything going on around you that's kind of distracting you throughout the week? High gas prices, high food prices, insurance, whatever else the thing may be. Relationship, health, finances, throw it all in there. Get our attention off the things that we're going around us and focusing things on heaven and our walk and our relationship with Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but sometimes my life doesn't go the way I plan. If you're like me, you're planning for retirement. Good luck. You desire to have good health. You're planning to live longer than your kids. You're planning your vacation. But the reality is, if you walk through your life focused on the here and now, forgetting or turning your back on the things of God, you will be discouraged and even defeated every single day. Because every single day, you're going to be discouraged. You're going to be let down by someone, something along your path. It's just going to happen. Don't believe me? Turn on the news sometime. That'll lift your spirits. But when you get a glimpse of heaven, when you just get that door opens up just a little bit, and you know that you're in the presence of God, when you see and experience the awesomeness and grandeur of heaven, your life down here, in the good times and even in the bad times, will begin to make sense, because you will have the right perspective and the right outlook in your life here and your life after. You see, it's not about here. It's all about the there. I can't wait. I'm going to worship here because one day I'm going to be there. Remember what John wrote in 1 John chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. He said this, in case you don't remember and don't have it memorized. Don't love the world or anything that belongs to the world. If you love the world, you cannot love the Father. Our foolish pride comes from this world, and so do our selfish desires and our desire to have everything we see. None of this comes from the Father. The world and the desires it causes are disappearing. But if we obey God, we will what? Live forever. Remember, it's not about your life now. It's not about your worship here. It's all about the worship you are preparing for when, and maybe even if for some, you get to heaven. Now on to the third point. The third one is going to sound a lot like the second point, but they are completely different, believe it or not. The third one is this. Worship is not about now, it's about then. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18 say this. I love those first four words. We what? We never give up. Give up. Our bodies are gradually dying. I agree with that. But we ourselves are being made stronger each day. These little troubles that are, isn't it amazing you didn't use the big ones? Just the little ones. These little troubles are getting us ready for an eternal glory that will make our troubles seem like nothing. Things that are seen don't last forever, but things that are not seen are eternal. That is why we keep our minds on the things that cannot be seen. In these verses, Paul is challenging the church at Corinth and us today to put everything that is going on in their or our life today in perspective of the incredible promise that we have in the future if we have a relationship with God, if we are followers of Christ. Take a look at the three comparisons that Paul makes in these verses as we just read through them. Our earthly bodies are dying. Hello. You know, used to be I could just jump right out of bed. Now hopefully I can just roll out of bed and maybe get off the floor to go to the bathroom in the morning. Been there, done that. We got aches and pains in parts of our body we didn't even know we had parts of our body to have aches and pains in. We used to be able to run. Now I can barely walk. I mean, that's just the way it is. Our bodies are dying. Our spiritual bodies are growing stronger every day if we're spending time with Jesus Christ. The little troubles we experience on a daily basis. He didn't say just once a week or once a month, whatever. The little troubles we experience on a daily basis are getting us ready for the glory and majesty of heaven, where the troubles that we have in this life today are going to seem like nothing. You got cut off in traffic? A little trouble. No big deal. You don't have to ram them or give them the pit maneuver and get them off the road. No need to do that. The stuff and the things that we think or believe are so important and valuable are temporary. They will not last. But one thing that we can't see, the things that God is doing in us and to us and through us, will last forever. You see, worship. Worship's a tunnel by which we get a glimpse of heaven. It tells us and shows us that the emptiness of this world is nothing compared to the majesty of heaven. That is why when you and I fail to worship, we confine ourselves, we focus into, we are consumed by the despair and loneliness and emptiness of this life if we focus on the world. You gotta love that old hee-haw song. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Deep down the trash. Yeah, we all know it. Most of us. That's the way it is. We focus in on that. How bad life is, how bad situation is compared to what it's going to be. You see, we should never take worship casually. Just kind of show up, we want to do something. It's not a casual thing, either in our churches or in our own personal life. That's why we should never be late for worship. Should never be late for worship. And we should never be disrespectful and distracted during our worship. Worship is your time with God. It is not to be taken lightly. Fourth thing. Worship is not about one, it's about many. Worship isn't just about you, what you like, or whatever else. It's about many. You see, when you make the decision to stay at home and not attend church, when you make the decision that yard work is more important than your attendance, when you make a statement like, I don't have to come to church to worship. I can worship on the beach. I can worship as I hike in the mountains. I can worship while I fish or play golf. I can stay at home and watch it on television. You are not just kidding yourself. You are dead wrong. Wrong. You can't worship by yourself. We're in a time when people are dropping out of church and not bothering to come, or cut back the times when they come to weekend church or services. I may show if I want to. You see, the problem is this, right? That when we do this, we are setting ourselves up for the danger of becoming individualistic worshipers. We're worshiping by ourselves. We're all alone. When you're sitting on your couch or in your boat or wherever else, or you just decide not to come, it's all about me. Let me share this with you. You cannot have true worship by yourself. Can't happen. Don't believe it? Check out these verses in Revelation that John took notice of while he was witnessing this incredible event up in heaven. I am not going to read them to you. You're going to have to do this on your own, so all you need to do is write down the references. Revelation chapter 5, verses 11 through 12. Many angels, not a few, not a couple, many angels, living creatures, elders, numbered into the 10,000s times 10,000s. There weren't just a couple people there. There wasn't just one person there. There was thousands, 10,000s, and millions of them worshiping together. Revelation chapter 14, verses 2 and 3. Singing a new song. One we've never heard before. Oh boy, that would be an exciting time for some, won't it? Jesus, excuse me. Angels, be quiet. I don't like that song. You going to tell God that? Just thought I'd ask. Singing a new song to living creatures and elders and a choir of over 140,000 singing that song together. Flowing from their very being. Revelation chapter 19, verse 6. A great multitude. How many? All right, saying and singing. What are they singing together? Can you imagine singing this together for hours and hours? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! For the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! For the Lord God omnipotent reigns. A guy by the name of Vernon Whaley said this, one day worshiper, you and I will be part of that great multitude, that choir from all nations. Not even just going to be Americans. There's going to be Russians and Chinese and Japanese. You know, all those bad people, they're going to be singing in the choir because God's working there too. People are coming to a relationship with Jesus Christ there as well. They're going to be singing in this mass choir, the choir from all nations. No one really knows what kind of choir it will be. Is it going to be a contemporary choir? Is it going to be a classical choir? Is it going to be a traditional choir? Is it going to be a gospel choir? Or maybe, here's one for you. I kind of just typed this one in little parentheses. Maybe it's going to be a rap choir. There you go. Talk about busting one. Boy, some of us would die. But could you imagine all of a sudden some rap and choir breaks out? That'd be cool. But it's not going to matter to us. And even if we can't carry a tune on earth, or you don't have a lick of musical talent, it's not going to matter. It's not going to matter. I guess I've probably told this before. I've got a cousin. Terry's since passed away. My kids never had the privilege of meeting Terry. He was mentally challenged, mentally handicapped. Knew all the records of the Chicago White Sox. Batting orders, batting averages, where they came from, all that. He knew it all. He knew cars. A car could be 3 miles away and Terry knew what car it was. He also couldn't sing. It was off key. And it was really, really, really. And they went to this really, really, really small church. And they were singing hymns. And Terry was singing much louder than anybody else. It was off key. It was loud. And you know what? Nobody cared. Because Terry wasn't singing for them. He wasn't singing for the music guy. He wasn't singing for anybody else except his God and his Savior, whom he loved more than anything else. He was singing. He didn't even need the words. He had them all memorized. And yet we stand back and we complain. Why are we singing this? I don't even like it. Doesn't matter. You're not singing it for yourself. You're singing it to him. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Forever God is faithful. I don't like that. It's got too much drum beat or something in it. But you know what? He's still faithful whether you want him to be or not. He's still holy whether you want him to be or not. It's not going to matter. You see, you and I and all who love Jesus Christ will be qualified and we will join the eternal chorus and together our voices will sound across the universe and universes in one unified statement. We love Jesus. He is worthy to be praised. Jesus. So if this is where we're headed, if this is where you are planning to go when you die, you better start rehearsing immediately. Not just here. I'm not talking about hand raising or dancing around or anything else. Hey, if you feel like doing that, go for it. Don't matter to me. You know, I was the first church of the Nazarene, big church, Nashville, Tennessee. You know, we had a wraparound balcony. Some guy got so blessed by the Lord, he had quadruple bypass. This was back in the 70s, early 80s, he got up there and he just goes, woo! Kicked off his shoe into the balcony. That's hilarious. He was excited because God blessed him. God had blessed him. He was thankful to God. And he just stood right up in there. You know, a hymnal singing church. He just got up and he got blessed in the Lord and he just kicked his shoe right off. Somebody just took it and threw it right back down to him. He didn't care. Why? Because he was worshiping his God. He was saying, thank you that I am alive to be here today to worship you and praise you with all the other people that are here together. We love Jesus. He is worthy to be praised. So this is where you're headed. You better start rehearsing now. And after all, there's no guarantee how long we'll have to get ready. That's the sad thing about it. How much more practice time are we going to have? Don't know. That is why we need to sing praise to the Lord today. So if the Lord comes while you're out to lunch, maybe working, mowing the grass, sleeping, sitting in a church service, or sleeping in a church service, whatever, you better start practicing. Better start warming up those vocal cords, getting on your dance shoes, you know, loosening those arms to be raised in worship of the King. Why? One simple reason, because He is Jesus. He is Jesus. He is Jesus. And He alone is worthy to be praised. Worship. Don't take it lightly. If you go to heaven, you're going to be worshiping a long, 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 long time. In fact, that's just about all you're going to be doing, is worshiping Him. Because you get to see Jesus face to face. Let's pray together. Jesus, thanks. God, sometimes we get our worship confused. In fact, sometimes we get it messed up. Sometimes we just don't feel like it. I don't know how that happens. Well, I do, because you know what? Daily stuff comes and we focus on, well, man, I don't have enough money to pay my light bill, right? I got to choose between my light bill and my prescriptions, or, you know, my car needs gas, but who in the world can, you know, fill it up? I mean, I don't even have enough money to put 20 bucks in there and get me 4 gallons of gas just to do whatever it is I got to do. And, you know, I got to go to the doctor and I can't, just whatever it is. But God, don't let that interfere, because you are still God. You are still the light. You are still Yahweh. You are still Adonai. You are still the beginning and the end. You're still the Rose of Sharon. You're still the Word and the light. You're still powerful. God, you're all those things. God, most of all, you're worthy of our praise. God, I just pray that you just bless us and use us. Lord, let us worship this week. Lord, let us come back next week expecting God to do something exciting in our life because of the worship we've had throughout the week. God, as we go home today, as we maybe go out to eat or have interaction with somebody else, Lord, just let us just put on that smile, that shine, that they look at us and go, what in the world is wrong with you? Why are you smiling? You just look at them and say, because He's gone. He's God. Lord, bless our tithes and our offerings that we bring this morning. Lord, just use them in miraculous and wonderful ways. Thank you for folks who couldn't be here this morning or just chose not to be here. Whatever, just bless them. Lord, just give us a great week. In the wonderful, awesome, incredible, powerful name of Jesus. All God's people said together. Amen. Let's all stand up and sing as we have an offering this morning to God.